All right, guys, I think it's time. It's finally time we need to stop buying the traditional market cap weighted index fund. What's up, you guys? Welcome back to the Average Joe Investor Channel. My name is Joe, and in this video, we're diving into a topic that I think can be a little bit controversial. I'm sure that people are gonna fall on both sides of this argument, but I feel like the evidence points to the fact that we've just got to stop purchasing the traditional market cap weighted index funds. Specifically in this video, we're gonna talk about what exactly is a market cap weighted index fund. We're gonna compare that and contrast that with other types of index funds available. Secondly, we're gonna talk about why is this a problem? Why should we stop buying them and why should we stop buying them now? And then thirdly, we're gonna talk about some alternative options available to us that we can buy instead of buying these types of index funds. You guys know I never like to waste your time. I always wanna add massive value every time I put out a new video. So without further delay, let's get started. Hey guys, Joe here. If you're new to the channel, make sure to hit that subscribe button below the video to make sure you don't miss any of my future videos. And if you do click that subscribe button, make sure to leave me a comment below saying you subscribed, and I promise to personally respond to your comment. All right, guys, let's dive right into this. The first thing we need to think about is, well, what exactly is a market cap weighted index fund? Now, when I say market cap weighted, I mean market capitalization weighted. When I say market capitalization, we're talking about the total value of a specific stock. So when we think about one of the most common indexes out there, the S&P 500 index, this is an example of a market capitalization weighted index fund. When it's weighted by market capitalization, it means that the largest companies in the index also have the largest weighting in the index. So companies like Microsoft and Apple and Google, there's a significantly more weighting in these specific stocks versus the other, let's say, 497 different stocks. Most people, I think, when they think they're buying an index fund and they hear that they're gonna purchase the S&P 500, I think some people think they're probably getting an equal weighting in each of the 500 companies. Or even if they don't think that's true, they probably think they're getting a much more significant weighting than they actually are. So that's a market capitalization weighted index fund. This is actually, I would say, the most common type of index fund out there, whether it's the S&P 500, the Russell 2000, the NASDAQ 100, and everything in between. Most of the traditional index funds are market capitalization weighted. So what's the problem? Let's talk about the big problem here. The truth is, over time, specifically over the past, I'd say, 5 to 7 years, the amount of weighting in the top companies has gotten significant. I found this really great infographic here that speaks to what the top 10 weightings look like. See, there's 500 companies in the S&P 500, but if we look here over this time lapse here from 1990 through 2020, we can see here the top five companies in 1990 only made up 12.3% of the portfolio. And then it was as high as 16.6% here in 1999, right before the tech bubble burst. And then in 2006, we were at 12.6%. This is before the housing crisis. This right here is 11% after the housing crisis. Then in 2013, Apple was the top one here at 3.1%. It was only 11.1% for the top five here. Then 10.9% in 2016, all very stable, I think, when you think about, you know, being a market capitalization weighted index fund. But now here, we're looking at September of 2020, we're at 22.6% in just the top five companies. And if we come over here to the Vanguard S&P 500 ETF, VOO is the ticker symbol, and we scroll down to portfolio management and we look just here at this weighting, 510 companies, 510 different stocks in the S&P 500 ETF. And you'll notice here, we scroll down to month end 10 largest holdings. We've got Apple, Microsoft, Google, which its parent company is Alphabet. Then we've got Amazon, Facebook, Tesla, Nvidia, Berkshire Hathaway, JP Morgan Chase, and Johnson & Johnson. These top 10 holdings make up just under 30% of the net assets. So the top 10 get 30%, the bottom 490 only get 70%. And you can see here, the specific weightings, 6.1% in Apple, 5.8% in Microsoft. Google makes up 4.2%, Amazon at 3.9%, and Facebook at 2.2%, followed closely by Tesla at 1.7%. And then the other ones are only at 1.4, 1.4, 1.3, and 1.2. We can actually take a look at the total holdings for the entire portfolio. So look at how small some of these are. Market value for the top companies, right? We've got Apple at $46 billion in this ETF is the market value, 329 million shares. And the lowest holdings here, these are still the top 500 companies here. Unum Group, they only own $4,000, 165 shares, makes up like less than 0.01% of the portfolio. News Corp, Berkshire Hathaway Class A, Lennar Corporation, Under Armour, Discovery, these are big companies. They make up such a significantly small portion of the portfolio. Now, so more than ever before, we are very top heavy when it comes to both industry as well as just the number of companies. 30% of the portfolio for just 10 companies. 23% when we factor in just the top 5 companies, and they're all pretty much in the information technology sector of the economy. So what's the solution here? How can we potentially diversify outside of just these top holdings? Well, I like to share with you what I do myself, because I have been concerned about this problem for a number of years. This is why for many years now, I have not owned the S&P 500 or the Total Market Index Fund. You might notice with Vanguard's Total Market Index Fund, they've got over 3,500 holdings. It's still a market capitalization weighted fund, which means that the top 10 holdings still are making up 30% of the portfolio, which leaves, 3,400 holdings to fight over the other 70%. That's not diversification in my humble opinion. So what's the solution here? What is an alternative way to capture, diversification with, yes, the largest companies in the world, but also having it spread out amongst other mid-sized companies, other large companies, and small-sized companies? And we can achieve this by owning index funds. That's what I do in my own portfolio. I'd like to share that with you right now. All right, guys, here is my Roth IRA account, which I hold with Fidelity. And this is where I actually practice this. I don't own just a large cap or a total market index fund. In my Roth IRA, which represents a small portion of my overall investment portfolio, you can see here I've got 4 different investments, including the market total, the money market here, which is essentially a cash fund. We've got the Fidelity Zero International Index Fund, Fidelity Small Cap Index Fund, Fidelity Mid Cap Index Fund, and the Schwab Large Cap ETF. So you'll notice here that the holdings are pretty equally weighted, these bottom three here. We've got large cap at 30%, which is now at 31.15. Then we've got the Mid Cap Index Fund right here, which started at 30%, now it's at 30.64%. We've got the Small Cap Index Fund started at 30%, now it's at 28.58%. And then the Zero Fund started at 10, and now it's at 9.63%. So this is the specific weighting that I felt was most representative of what I wanted to accomplish here, 30, 30, 30, and then 10 for large, mid, small cap, and 10% for international. You can come up with the same thing yourself, or you can just decide to have a different weighting based on what you would like to accomplish. If you wanna go more information technology heavy, you can go heavier in the large cap funds if you'd like. What this strategy does though, is it spreads out our diversification, actually gives us access to more different stocks. And what you'll find with the mid cap and the small cap index funds is they're not quite as top heavy. They're still market cap weighted, but they're not as top heavy, and they're much more diversified than the large cap or the S&P 500 index funds. An alternative to actually owning the S&P 500 ETF through the traditional market capitalization weighted ETF, and an alternative to using the large, mid, and small cap weightings for different index funds, you can also utilize the what's called an equal weighted index fund, which is instead of doing a traditional market capitalization weighting, instead they take all 500 companies and you get each an equal slice of each company. Here's an ETF you can go and purchase, RSP from Invesco, the Invesco S&P 500 equal weighted ETF. As you can see down here, it does have a higher management fee or expense ratio at 0.2% versus 0.03% for Vanguard, but that's still not a significant price to pay. Does this mean you have to stop owning the S&P 500 or the total market fund? No, that's not the case at all. The point here is that we need to have awareness on what we own here. We think we're owning a massive diversification ETF, And we're not. We're really owning a significant portion of the largest companies in the United States, and you know, a little bit, a very, very, very little bit of other companies as well. As long as we're okay with that, then by all means, continue forth doing the same thing you've always done. But if you thought you were getting more diversification than you actually are, if you're looking for more alternatives to spread out your diversification and your risk across more companies and more sectors of the economy, then potentially a look at large, mid, and small cap ETFs at an exposure level you would like to accomplish might be a better fit for you. Make sure to leave your 2 cents in the comments below, guys. Let me know what other videos you'd like to hear from me or see from me on the channel. And just give me feedback on this video. What did you like? What didn't you like? What would you like to see more of from me in the future? As a reminder, you can always join the Patreon community. There's a link in the description below. For as little as $5 a month, you can get access to a lot more dividend content if that's what your focus is right now, whether you're trying to build up a dividend portfolio right now or you're in retirement looking to live off dividends. Check out the link in the description below. You might find some incredible value out of that Patreon community. That's all I got for you guys in this video. Have a great rest of your day, and please continue to stay healthy, both physically and financially. Have a good one.